said, "We have come up to bind Samson, to do to him as he did to us." Then 3,000 men of Judah went down to the cleft of the rock at Edom and said to Samson, do you not know that the Philistines are rulers over us? What then is this that you have done to us?" And he said to them, "As they did to me, so have I done to them."
There we go. Good evening, church.
Good evening.
Thought for a second I was just going to be doing a lot of yelling for a few minutes. Well, gladly we don't have to suffer that this evening. Open up your Bibles to the 15th chapter of the book of Judges. I've got just a few words to share with everyone this evening. I've been looking forward to this. It is still Mother's Day, and right away you're thinking, Judges, Mothers, this doesn't seem like it's going to go together very well. And you're probably going to think that for a few moments, but I hope that what we talk about tonight will be encouraging and uplifting, especially for the mothers that we have here, and also for everyone else, because I think it applies. One of my favorite authors, C.S. Lewis, wrote this. He wrote that homemaking is surely in reality the most important work in the world. What do ships, railways, mines, cars, government, etc. exist for, except that people may be fed, warmed, and safe in their own homes? The homemaker's job is one for which all others exist. I think there's a lot of humbling truth in that. For all of men's endeavors and all of the things we get excited and stressed about, what would it be worth if there was not a home to come home to? And that's an utterly redundant use of the word home, but we're going to skip right through it and continue on. In our passage tonight, Judges chapter 15, we'll be a little bit in chapter 16 as well. We're picturing the men of Judah coming to Samson, who's been appointed a judge over the nation, and they're going to turn him over to the Philistines. And they go to bind him with 3,000 fighting men on the top of the rock, and they say to Samson, "Don't you know that the Philistines are rulers over us?" And it takes just a little bit of background context to understand what a pivotal moment in the history of the nation of Israel this actually is, and how surprising this actually is, and how important it actually is. But before we get to that, and we tie all of this ugliness into one happy little bow, I want to say that you probably already guessed there are two words that every mother needed to hear today, and if they haven't heard it yet, we're going to give it to them right now. What are those two words, moms? That's three words. We'll start small and we'll escalate to I love you, but thank you. What about thank you? Does that mean a lot to the moms here? I think it means a lot to anybody when you hear a genuine thank you, does it not? People pay a lot of lip service these days. We'll talk a little bit about that in just a few minutes, but you'd never underestimate the power of a genuine recognition of thanks and gratitude. I call it giving someone a like in real life. You guys that are on... Yeah, you're on social media now? Just think about this for a second. We're so jaded and we're so starved for actual interaction with people, actual real meaningful connection, real gratitude, real thanksgiving, real emotion, that when someone writes on your Facebook wall, "Happy birthday," who never talks to you any other day of the year, you're like, "Look at you. Happy birthday." But just stop and think about that. That's how bitter we are that someone actually took the time out of their day. Even the few seconds that it takes to type happy birthday, they did that and we meet it with, "Psh, where are you the other 364 days? I've been getting old for a long time, man. Why didn't I hear from you till today?" Think about that. Think about how much of a difference it makes if you go out tonight or tomorrow and give someone a like in real life. Pay a genuine compliment. Say thank you to mom. Not just happy Mother's Day, not your day, you can eat wherever you want for lunch. I mean, really. Look her in the eyes and say, thank you. Those are the two words that most everyone needs to hear, but especially mothers. And just for a few seconds here before we jump into Samson, I promise this will come together. But for a few minutes here, isn't motherhood really maybe the most difficult job on the planet, if you're being honest? Guys, I don't want you just nodding along because you don't want to get slapped in. you know, and you want to have peace, you know, when you get home. I don't want that. Let's acknowledge what it really is. You don't really truly realize it until you've either been in very, very close proximity to it after you've grown up, or you've actually gone through it. And over the years, I watched my own mom, Jana, who's not here tonight, but she'll probably be here next week, and you'll get to meet her. And I spared her by not putting a picture of her up there from like 1987, right? We'll save that for when she's actually here so she can be really mad at me that day. But, you know, I watched her, you know, walk that path, and then even through my professional endeavors, and I've built relationships with other moms all over the country and people who have spent most of their lives as mothers, and I've witnessed incredible things that come with being a mom. Crazy schedules, right? Busy is the new badge of honor in our society. Hey, how are things going? I'm busy. Everybody says that. But before everybody was busy, moms have been busy, let's be honest. Crazy schedules, never-ending to-do lists, dwindling amounts of sleep. I just spent some time in Nashville with a friend who's a traveling nurse, and his wife stays home with their 2-year-old and their 8-month-old, and I experienced the dwindling amount of sleep with them for those 3 days that I was there. I don't know how she does it. I don't know how you've all done it. Whenever I asked a mom who was a full-time mom, which I don't know why we had to start calling it full-time mom, as if it ever stopped before, I asked her, you know, what do you do, really? I mean, what's this like? And she said, I have no idea, but I do it all day. I can't even describe it. When I spoke all over, I talked to moms all over the country, and they seem to encounter the same 3 problems, and I just want to know if it's the same problems that moms or people close to moms have experienced here tonight as well. They were way too busy all the time. That's number 1. We don't feel like we have enough time in the day. Number 2, they spend the rest of their days bogged down by stress, which limits their productivity, and then they beat themselves up about all they still have to do. So busy and stressed, and then paramount is that they feel too tired to really enjoy the moments that they're fighting for and all of that other time. And they're zapped out. And they feel like the weight of the world is on their shoulders. And you know, there are certain things until you've been it that you can't really offer good advice on. I can really give no good pertinent advice to people about being a mom because I haven't been one. And you guys will say, isn't that precious? Or you might look at me if I'm trying to give you advice about how your day's really not that stressful, and you might say, bless your heart. That's the polite way of saying, you're kind of an idiot, Marcus. You don't know what you're talking about. You know, the advice that I would try to give really doesn't fit, but the thing about Scripture is that it surprises me in ways that I don't expect, and we find parallels, and we find different pieces of Scripture that fit into our lives in ways that we never otherwise could have seen happening if not authored by God. So what I hope that'll happen tonight for just a few minutes as we look at this encounter is that you moms, who maybe haven't found some common ground with this almost, he's a really famous Bible character, is he not? He's almost nefarious. It's kind of weird that he carries kind of like this bad connotation with him, but he's a good guy. This guy Samson, you probably have never seen yourselves in his shoes, but I hope that we all do, and especially you moms this evening. And maybe we can take one step away from survival mode and into a better life. So this is going to seem a little bit strange, and from this day forward, this will be my little weird, unique go-to recommendation for moms when they're feeling overwhelmed. The story of Samson. Yes. Burly, braggadocious, angry, violent Samson, and that is in no way a reflection of my experience with my own mom growing up. That's not a commentary on moms at all. There's a couple moms like, yeah, I see what you did, that's really subversive. I see what you're really saying about us. No, not at all. Even though this is geared mostly towards the moms, I, as a husband and son, find some value here. So, guys, we're not out in the cold tonight. I want you to stick with me. There's a lesson here for us as well. And one more thing before I get started on this text. I want you to seek out a mom. It doesn't even have to be your mom. And do what we talked about at the very beginning and just say thank you. Say thank you. Because even if it's not your mom and she was a loving, wonderful mom to someone else, then you owe her for making society a little bit better and your life a little bit easier. So find a mom who hasn't had someone to say thank you and tell her thanks. Now, let's talk about this period of the Judges so we can see how this even makes sense being talked about in the scheme of the same Bible class on this Sunday night. Okay? So what is going on in the period of the judges? We know that Israel is without a king. From time to time, they would do what judges says again and again and again what was right in their own eyes. And if you were looking for further application to our modern day, you need go no further. But because they were doing what was right in their own eyes, they always found themselves in predicaments. They found themselves in idolatry. They found themselves doing things they ought not to be doing. And things were really ugly a lot of times during the period of the judges. And God would appoint a judge. He would rise them up, and they would have to save them from the surrounding neighbors that would always come in and check Israel to get them back in line. They dealt with the Moabites. They dealt with a lot of different groups of people that made life painful for Israel. And they were always seeming to fight somebody that was at the borders, threatening their freedom, threatening their sovereignty, threatening everything that they thought they were in possession of this promised land. And Samson is one of those judges, but it's a very difficult time to be a judge. And here is why. Because when they were pestered before by surrounding nations, Israel would cry out to God. And they would say, you know, we're sorry, we need help. And God would deliver them by bringing a judge into play. But something really, really scary has happened by the time Samson arrives on the scene. And that is that the Philistines are lords over Israel, and guess what? They're not really upset about it anymore. I want you to stop and think about the implications of the situation at this point in time. They're being occupied. They can't really do anything without the Philistines giving, you know, them permission. And that means that all of the promises of Abraham are in jeopardy. That means if they're assimilated into Philistine culture, then this whole promised people, promised land, promised Messiah, all nations of the earth, blessed by your descendants thing, goes away because we're all bowing down to worship Dagon, who wears a fish head and he's a really crazy, violent idol. This is a serious problem. And we see this by what happens in our text in chapter 15. Now, Samson has made a bad decision. He's tried to marry someone he wasn't supposed to marry. But it's interesting that the scripture says that God was actually using this. It was actually how God wanted it to be. So for any mom who's ever seen their child, son or daughter, make a decision that you knew was the wrong decision to make and there was nothing you could do to stop it. Ever been there? And you just had to wait and see. See, there's some people looking at their mom right now back there. It's happening right now. This is not giving, I'm not giving you my cosign to keep making bad decisions. Don't take what I'm about to say and twist it. But here's the reality. There's no way that Samson's mom could have understood that his bad decision was what God was going to use. It says for an opportunity against the Philistines. His bad decision was what God was going to use to save Israel from itself, and they didn't even know it. And they didn't even know it so much so to the extent that they were going to be angry at Samson for provoking the Philistines. And that's what we read in our scripture just a few seconds ago. Now, this is right after Samson has done one of the coolest things in all of scripture, tied 300 foxes' tails together and set them loose through the Philistines' fields and destroyed their entire crop. It was a really crippling move, right? First of all, never mind the fact that, you know, he set the stuff on fire. I don't know how you catch 300 foxes, and then my weird mind says, what were 300 foxes doing that close together? This must have been a land plagued by foxes, and if there were that many foxes, wouldn't you be kind of glad that there weren't so many foxes anymore? But I digress. This is the situation, and the Philistines are very, very upset. And they come to the elders, and they come to Samson, and they say, hey, Samson, what have you done? Don't you know these guys are rulers over us? So, the Philistines are rulers over Israel. It's not supposed to be that way. Every other time someone's tried to be a ruler over Israel, they've rebelled. They've got a notorious history and reputation throughout the world. Of any time you try to occupy these people, there's going to be problems. But this time, there's no problems. They're just accepting it. That the least they could do is come back with a little bit of appreciation. Wouldn't you think? But instead, in the course of motherhood, Mom, or a door slammed in your face, or in this case, the Israelites show up and they say, hey, Samson, you know what, man? This is messed up. We're going to turn you over. We're going to tie you up. We're not going to kill you ourselves, but we're going to give you to the Philistines. And like, come what may, if they decide to end you, fine. You know,
you could have expected thank you, you know, a little bit of appreciation. Thanks for getting the Philistines off of our back. Thank you for letting them know that there's a new judge in town. Thank you for letting them know that we are the children of the God of Abraham, Isaac, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that we are the rightful possessors of this land. I think I need a battery. Thank you. I feel really awkward now. So here is Samson. He's just doing literally what he was called by God to do, what he was born for, what he was destined for. And there's not so much as a thank you, just, we're going to turn you over to the Philistines now. That's much better. Sorry, guys. See, I get so excited I didn't even notice that it went out. It's a problem. Samson has to feel in this moment like the world is kind of on his shoulders, don't you think? The Atlas Syndrome, if there was ever someone in the history of the world that was actually capable of carrying that boulder. You know the Atlas sculpture? The guy holding the world up on his shoulders? Samson was the guy who could have accomplished it. The power of the Holy Spirit that was on him. But even he had to feel betrayed at this moment. How does that moment feel when you can see something that the person you're trying to help can't see, and all that is returned to you is animosity and anger? They turn you over to someone and just say, you know what? You're dead to me. That's essentially what they're saying to Samson at this point in time. Moms, do you ever feel like if you don't do it, then it's not getting done? Yeah? I've even felt like that. I know Samson felt like that. Because if Samson isn't the one that's going to fight the Philistines, no one else is going to fight for them. No one else is going to step up and do this. Everyone else is placated. Everyone else is willing to live a life of subservience and slavery. Samson's all alone. And you know how the story goes from there? They turn him over, and you know, in our text, he breaks free of the bonds that they try to bind him with, and he ends up going, and he takes the jawbone of a donkey, and he smites so many Philistines. And I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on that, but the point is that without all of this transpiring, he would have never had that opportunity to provoke Philistia like it was talking about in the scripture back in chapter 14 and verses 4 and 5. It says, he smites those Philistines. He says a little poem after that when he finishes with it. But the reality is, from this point forward in his life, Samson begins to be bound by the things that are his responsibilities, and he begins to be bound by the things and decisions and choices that he has made that he cannot change. If you're reading along with me, you know who gets introduced in chapter 16. We're familiar with this story. They even write songs about it. Romeo and Juliet, Samson and Delilah. Delilah shows up and she spends her entire life trying to figure out how to tie Samson down. And he just finds himself encumbered with all of these things, different attempts to strap him down and keep him from being what God has called him to be. And though I've never been bound like that physically, but the responsibilities of life sometimes make me feel this way. There's so many things that take away my choice of what I want to do and what I get to do. What's it like to have a child? Was it that bad? Are we that bad? She almost fainted. She's, Your life changes really quick, doesn't it? All of a sudden, there's this little Afro puff running around screaming at the top of his lungs. You guys know a little bit about that now, minus the Afro. I kind of was doing the same thing way back in the day. But all of a sudden, your goals, your hopes, your dreams, your aspirations are no longer your own. And all of a sudden, you find out that life is about somebody else now. And for all of Samson's strength and his braggadocious nature and all of his confidence, he's very quickly brought to a place where he realizes that, you know, this whole life of strength and power is actually not about me anymore, and it probably never was. You see, when the weight of the world is too much to bear, Samson found himself in chapter 16, and if you read in verses 23 with me here. Chapter 16, In verse 23, we see what happens after they finally bind Samson. It says, "Now when the lords of the Philistines gather to offer a great sacrifice to Dagon, their god, and rejoice, they said, 'Our god has given Samson, our enemy, into our hand.' And when the people saw him, they praised their god, for they said, 'Our god has given our enemy into our hand, and the ravager of our country has killed many of us.' And when their hearts were merry, they said, 'Call Samson that he may entertain us.' So they called Samson out of the prison, and he entertained them, and they made him stand between the pillars. Samson said to the young man who held him by the hand, 'Let me feel the pillars of which the house rests, and that I may lean against them.' Now the house was full of men and women, and the lords of the Philistines were there. And on the roof there were 3,000 men and women who looked while Samson entertained." In verse 28, Samson's going to call on the Lord, but I just want to speak a second to the fact that he has reached the low of the low at this point. This is a guy who's probably the strongest person ever to have lived, without a doubt. So strong and has such a reputation, in fact, that later Greek myths would take up his moniker and he would be mentioned in mythologies all the way down into today. And for such power and such invulnerability, now he finds himself in a place with his eyes gouged out. He can't even see anymore. And he's in prison and now he's brought up to entertain like some kind of monkey grinding spectacle in front of his enemies. And all of his physical torment, the things that he's going through and experiencing internally, are all really analogous to different chapters and places in life where we find out that we really can't see as well as we thought we could either. And we feel like we've been betrayed. And we feel like we've been bound. And we feel like the world is on our shoulders. And all we're looking for is a little bit of rest. Everyone knows that moment when you've been to the end of your rope, don't you? Now, I'm speaking to moms again here exclusively because every mom has a moment when, okay, let's be, every woman has a moment when, and guys, you know the moment when things get real and you know you've just crossed the line? There's a signature anger that comes out. Stop looking at them right now. You're going to see it later. There's a moment, sometimes they get really quiet. Sometimes they get really red. Sometimes you just hear stomping noises upstairs, a slammed door, or there's an iconic phrase. Any mother have an iconic phrase when they were at the end? This is going to get me in trouble. My mom had an iconic phrase. She had two twin sisters. They came up 4 years after me, and that meant when the Afro Puff got a little bit bigger and the twins that came behind him realized that he could get in trouble when they made a lot of noise, and then I rebelled against that, that meant there was a lot of noise to deal with. And there were lots of little fights that were really about nothing. And my mom said this thing that let me know when it just got real. If I ever heard mom say this, "You guys make me want to chop my own head off." Hey guys, we better. She's not even threatening us anymore. She's threatening herself. Mom's serious. Everybody has a moment like that. Every mom has a moment like that. But moms, have you had the moment that Samson is about to have when he's leaning against the pillar? When he prays this, in verse 28, he says, "O Lord God, please remember me and strengthen me only this once." Have you ever prayed that prayer, moms? Just get me through today. Lord, I don't know where, just right now, I need you just for a moment. I need to know that you are there. You know, when the bottom falls out. When nobody understands, when nobody recognizes. Men, have you prayed that prayer too? "Lord, just this once, I made her mad. She's speaking in another language. If you could just this once calm her, I need the peace that passes all understanding right now." Have you prayed that prayer for strength? I know there are times when sometimes we really want out of there. And I imagine that Samson really wanted out of this situation very badly. And it reminds me of a lady that I know and who is close to me, who is one of the greatest examples of motherly love, not just to her children and her family, but to everyone else who she comes in contact with. You know, one of those moms that makes her life about taking care of other people. Anybody know a mom like that? Anybody know a person like that? There's always cookies somehow, no matter how crazy their life has been. There's always some form of baked good that's going out to somebody who's in need. There's always some charitable action being done. And you're wondering, woman, how do you have this much time to be doing this much stuff? And I know how crazy your life is, and I don't know how you do it. I know a friend who was going through that. and debt started to stack up in their family, and it brought additional pressure. Anybody ever felt the pressure of debts that they weren't sure what they were going to do about? Well, that stresses you as a parent, stresses you as a spouse. It started to stack up against their family, and they've got three different children, and one of them is really sick, and they weren't sure what was going on, and so the medical bills are stacking up now, and the doctors can't diagnose what is wrong with this kid, so they're going all over the country to specialists, and they're trying some homeopathic, and they're trying some regular treatment, and there's really no end in sight. There's no light at the end of the tunnel. Nobody can tell them what is wrong. They've got this going on top of a bank error, which caused their house to be foreclosed on. And the bank finally worked back and fixed it, but that was not until after a month of tremendous stress and thinking that they were going to be homeless, and then she lost her job. And when it rains, it pours, you know that? This was a situation where I watched a woman who gave nothing but love to everyone who ever crossed her path, for some inexplicable reason, just experiencing wave after wave after wave after wave. And she had the Atlas syndrome too. And she was trying to carry it. She called me one night and she said, "Marcus, I need to let you know that I've been paying lip service to God. I've been praying to God and talking to God and telling myself that I'm giving all of this stuff over to God and I'm letting Him handle it, but it's not true. I would take it to God and I would lay it at His feet and then I would get worried and then I would pick it right back up again. And I've been trying to carry this and I want to let you know that I can't do it anymore. This morning I had it all planned out over the last week. I had it all planned out. I called off of work and I was going to take a drive today and I was just never going to make it back. And the only way that I thought that our family could survive what we're going through now is if I had an accident and they could collect the insurance policy. And that's the only way that I could save my family from what we're going through right now. I thank God that I didn't get a different phone call. I thank God that she didn't go through with that. I thank God that she realized that though she was saying to God, I'm going to let you have it, she really wasn't. And I thank God that I have the opportunity to speak to any moms or any person, male or female, tonight to say, you can't carry this world alone, Mom. You can't do it. Samson couldn't do it. I can't do it. And we know you try, and it is admirable. And it is beautiful, and you are stronger than we know, but you can't carry this world alone. And you shouldn't have to. You see, Jesus came, and He carried the sin of the world so that you don't have to carry it all anymore. And it's easier said than done, isn't it, to rest in that peace, to rest in that truth? But if I could only leave you with one thing, other than the fact that it's really weird that mothers probably find themselves feeling like Samson more often than not, a thankless job that has to be done, commissioned by God, for which our entire society would crumble if we didn't have you. But only the words of Jesus can lead you where you need to be in order to see it through. You know, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 11, beginning in verse 28, "Come to me all who labor and are weary, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Come to me all who are weary." Those are the words of Jesus. He came and He carried what He carried so that you don't have to. He came and carried what we could never hope to carry on our own. And when we try, the end, our legacy will just be tragic. But the alternative, letting Jesus do what He came to do, and trusting Him that it's not all on you, can be a beautiful fulfillment of all of the effort that you have put in and all of the love that you give out each and every day. I don't know if we're having an invitation song this evening. I'm still a little bit new. Someone give me a thumb. We are. So I want to let you know, if you have a burden to lay down this evening, Jesus stands ready to carry what He came to carry. For you, moms, and for you, dads. sons, and daughters, all who would be called by his name. If we could assist you, would you come as we stand and sing?